That's definitely recording. That's a bright red light.
Yeah, this is going.
All right, good. All right,
so like you tap my face, you gotta tap my face and I'll tap yours.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
But you can't get up and move again.
Well, I mean a little bit. It'll once it zooms in on me, like great. But
oh, yeah, I'll
just do me. So it should hone in. So is that recording? Okay.
13 seconds in.
Right on.
Yeah. Oh, no glassware.
It's all right. Product endorsement.
All right.
I mean, we can take a break, too, after.
It's cold.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh. I'm an adult human being. I can cope with cold hands.
Arizona is a wildly beautiful place, brimming with over 100 brewing companies.
I'm Rob Fulmer, the Executive Director of the Arizona Craft Brewers Guild.
I'm joined by Deputy Director Andrew Bauman. Together we cover the state, bringing you the best of what's happening at our breweries and beyond. Welcome to Arizona Beer Frontier.
You know, there's a literary thing where like someone has a list of things that what period would that be? Elizabethan women died of, like in books, like cold hands, ennui, boredom, miasma. That's hilarious. Whoa.
It's tough getting in and out of this joint. It's a little tricky.
Wow. You know, because we're recording multiple tracks, I could literally pot in the music, but that's for another time. We've got a level of complexity here that I don't know if I'm comfortable with yet.
What's more complex than normal?
We got the cameras facing, I can't even tell if they're on.
Close ins, that's true.
We'll see. We'll see.
Yeah.
Like we've got backups, we've got fail safes and all that
yeah.
stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, that's good news.
I want to start out with a non-alcohol. We're still drinking this hop splash. Wonderful people at Sierra Nevada.
Delicious.
It's
delicious.
Not a product endorsement. No money has changed hands. It is
only hoppy water.
It's an endorsement for not having a beer if you don't want one.
That's right.
I'm going to want one later.
I've been continuing the NA party at my house.
Yes. We have some NAs from a previous event. We will drink them. Future show. Probably put them in the refrigerator yes. so they're more enjoyable.
I'm having a 10 years gone India Pale Ale. This is a beer that Dragoon brewed in cooperation with Tap and Bottle for their 10 year anniversary. 10 yes. years gone.
Yes. And they're also having their 6 year at their Tap and Bottle North.
And that's.
And we cannot.
Oh, that was last weekend.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
I couldn't make it.
You couldn't make it either.
We were in Tucson quite a bit. So
yeah, I couldn't make it because I have responsibilities that I've been shirking for weeks.
We spent a lot of time in Tucson.
We traveled a lot.
But we
last
went to
month.
1912's anniversary.
Yeah, that was fun.
The cup is still broken.
Cup is still broken. That's not like, their fault, though.
No. But like, in terms of the lore of the Arizona Copper Cup, it has been used in a broken fashion in Tucson. It was originally broken in Tucson once, the base separated.
Ooh.
And that's why I always tell people to hold it from the bottom and not by the things.
Ears.
Because as we find out now, they can come off.
The other one's almost broken too.
Is it really?
Yeah, the bottom's already broken off. The top's like.
It's going to have to go to their shop, do you think? Or we have to,
we could just take them off.
No.
I don't think so either, but that was a suggestion made by someone.
Okay, well, we'll have to figure it out. Smash that like button if you want us to take it off. The ears of the, I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah, so I guess we covered, I mean, we went.
Tap and Bottle anniversary.
Yeah.
1912.
Yep. Governor's Conference.
Governor's Conference. We We did a whole episode from the governor's conference.
Right.
Didn't really talk about it, but.
No. We did that with Ayla.
Yeah.
Cool. Should listen to that.
And.
It's good.
The Old Ellsworth anniversary, which was on Saturday.
That's correct.
6 years.
You went there earlier. I went there later. Mm. There was a band that played. Nice band. I think we saw different bands, right?
Yeah, two different bands. They're great. Whoever I saw was great.
I saw Notes from Neptune.
They have a Saison. They actually have two Saisons. Mm. They have a Imperial Saison, Winnie's Saison, which is like 10% plus. Bonnie didn't realize that. And she got that as her first beer. And she said, I just got a Saison. Oh, whoops. And then she got the other one. It's a collab with Uncle Bear's, and it's a hibiscus Saison. It's very delicious.
Mm. I don't know why the camera turned off.
Okay.
It is also a lore of the show.
That the cameras turn off when they want to for no reason.
Maybe we have a ghost. Oh. We have some sort of curse.
Our ghost in my house is named Gary.
I don't
know what to say. When all of a sudden the toothbrush falls, you're like, Gary. What? That's Gary. Why is the motion detector light on in the laundry room, Gary?
I don't know that we have a name we could come up with a name for such a ghost that just turns cameras off.
Yeah. It's got to be a classic picture person.
Yeah. Someone with some narcissism. Like, camera's on me. The ghost. I'm the ghost. Wow. Okay, so... I guess I'm super amped and chatty because I just got off a conversation with my peers, Mary McDonald from Ohio, Paul Leone from New York, and myself. And it was hosted by John Hall from All About Beer. That is the Drink Beer, Think Beer podcast. Do I have those in the right order?
Drink Beer, Think Beer.
Yeah. And it was celebrating or discussing or... understanding what it's like to be in this industry for 10 years and the positions that we're in. All three of us were hired within the same couple of months. So that was cool.
Yeah, it's a very unique position.
I just felt like we were three quarters of the way in. I thought we were like, could have talked for another hour. Of course, that's not going to happen. And the tight ship that John Hall
runs. He does.
He goes over by a couple minutes. And he doesn't like to edit out stuff all the time. Like,
got it.
He says he will, but he's not going to listen to this.
I got a thing here, too.
Do I?
Yeah.
Man. All right, I'll just talk.
It's still there. Closed. And you can't even see it. Oh, man. Sorry. It's still there. Yeah, it's definitely there. It's a big boy.
Well, it's something for our video watchers to enjoy.
Now you can edit that out. John would leave it in. Yeah, well... we got to learn a lot at the Governance Conference on Tourism about what the goals are, and they're doing a rebrand.
Yeah.
I missed the first beginning part.
I don't know where they landed. They just kind of asked us to bring out some words.
Yeah.
And they really pushed it towards all the senses, so I don't know how it's going
to... They showed a couple of... there's New Mexico True.
Yeah.
And Tennessee... No.
Yeah. Kentucky,
yes.
Was that what it was?
Yeah.
I only watched it to see if they put beer in their commercials. And New Mexico has historically, if you remember before the pandemic, they've been advertising at Phoenix Sky Harbor for quite a while. And there was definitely large-scale pictures of people enjoying beer and also wine, which is fine. They have a wine industry there too. But I don't think Arizona's ever featured beer in their... video productions. If they have, they haven't done it with regularity in the way that I think they should. But Kentucky definitely put beer in theirs. Mm-hmm. And they have spirits and they have wine. We have spirits too, but like, I mean, they have a gigantic...
Yeah, traditional, long time running.
So I did industry. Make that point. Put some beer in the commercials. Yeah.
Yeah, and I got to meet a lot of people who I've already emailed with a couple times, and you know, staying top of mind is always a thing. And that doesn't happen unless you have someone constantly reaching out and having discussions and saying, how can we help? What do you, you know, all those things.
Yeah.
So that's a big thing for us this year, is to make sure we do get a little more recognition from the Office of Tourism.
Yes. Yes. And we'll make sure we have a commitment to a meeting with them in September. So we'll maybe get you an update on that after that occurs. They have a lot of money to spend on advertisement and bringing people and treating our breweries like other travel partners, meaning hotels and restaurants and wineries. And they need to bring the distilleries along as well, but we'll fight our battle first.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool.
Yeah. So, and then we're just kind of freelancing here. I did go to, I won't be able to make it to Greenwood's anniversary, third year anniversary.
Number three for Greenwood. We'll be going, Bonnie and I will go to that on Saturday.
Yeah.
Or Sunday. They're having a 2-day party.
So I will relate this story. They opened during the pandemic and they were right across the street from a large apartment building, and they had distancing and people went into the bar to get their beers. But everybody was on the patio, and I gave them their guild sign and welcome to the guild, did a little speech, and the cops rolled in and said, yeah, we have complaints that you guys are, I don't know, gathering too tightly.
Partying.
I don't know. But clearly we weren't, and they didn't hassle us other than to acknowledge in the middle of my speech. I'm like, explain who I was and this is what we're doing. And they didn't seem to have a problem. We just have to show up. So that is one interesting speech I had when opening a brewery. Front Porch, I had a windbreaker water during my speech. So those are two very memorable. And I know you've done it too. So someday maybe you can have a...
I only have done this one of Old Ellsworth.
Really?
Yeah, with the cup.
Okay.
I may have done 1912 one time.
Mm. Yeah.
No, I don't think so.
I think you've done 1912.
They just stood up on the bar and talked, and that was about it. I wasn't getting up on the bar. I don't do that.
Oh, okay.
Feet on bar is disgusting.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's not my favorite thing either, but...
No. Shoes are gross. Like, do you know what streets and sidewalks are so nasty? Anyways, that's beside the point. So this time when I was with Old Ellsworth, we're standing behind the bar in front of their giant logo and their taps, and it was super cool background. And as soon as I finished my little thing and handed it off to them, someone moved and knocked an entire shelf of glassware on the ground, and it just smashed. So that was pretty exciting.
Yeah.
That put a pretty big damper on the whole thing.
So although I won't be able to go to the anniversary for Greenwood, I did get to talk to Megan. I went there last night. The Axios, which is a news service which I've referenced in one of my Tools of the Trade episodes, where I talk about how I get informed and among other things that I use to do this job. And we're gonna have to do another one. I think when the weather's nicer, Andrew, you're gonna have to explain your vehicle.
Yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
Is that a tool? That is a tool of the trade, huh?
For you.
Nice. It's easy to do anything I want.
Do you know how like there's like this Instagram thing, just girl things?
No.
Hashtag. People do ridiculous versions of it, but I like to do just director things. Like, here's every wristband color that we've ever used in my car right now, you know, stuff like that, you know?
Oh, don't ever.
Here's a bunch of tin tackers.
Talk about the car. Like every beer rep knows. Mm-hmm. And just like us, your car just gets trashed from this business because you're just driving beer around all the time. And even if it's not leaking, it's sweating. And then that condensation's getting all over your stuff. And yeah.
Yeah.
My car's so trashed, mostly by me, but also by beer.
Anyway, I got to talk to Megan because it was Axios's 1-year anniversary. And I talked to some of the folks behind it, thanked them profusely about there is a Jessica Boehm, Boehm, B-O-E-H-M.
Mm-hmm.
She said it once, but I forgot. She and Jeremy Duda. Jeremy Duda was, I think he worked for the Capital Times. His beat was legislature. So I talked to him for a little bit, talked to Jessica. And then I ran into, I'm not going to say their name because I may reference some things that they said. But they worked for the governor's office in policy during the pandemic. And we commiserated about how how things.
The challenges.
Yeah. Yeah. And she was like, oh, it's so great to meet you in person. I'm like, I know it's great. Cause like, I just wanted to let her know. Cause I asked a lot of the governor's office and I said, these are the things we didn't get. Don't worry about it. I'm not, we're cool with it. Actually, we changed the law. And when that eventually happens, we'll see the benefits of that effort. I said, I would have liked to had it in just so, we had some standing and we were able to develop our process and all that stuff.
And is this the festival license you're talking about?
Okay. Yeah, I pitched to the governor's office to be able to have a to-go only festival. Because everyone was packaging, some people weren't comfortable going from brewery to brewery, perhaps. We could advertise to new customers like, hey, these are the things that they're doing and we're gonna order them and it'd just be a drive-through. And we just hand it out. Like, and you could still have beer reps there and like, you know, like
handing out swag.
Yeah. Talking to people.
Sure.
Yelling at their cars. Hey, thank you. However they wanted to do it, right? We were good at doing these distance festivals and virtual. And in fact, we did a socially distanced one at Old Ellsworth. So this is all kind of gelling together. But anyway, we started talking for a while. So that was super great. I also met somebody who will be in DC, at Representative Stanton's office. So I met him and maybe he can help us get a different kind of tour than we've gotten. He didn't make any, he actually is trying really hard to come up with something that we hadn't done yet. So we'll see what he comes up with.
Want to drink some beer in the, what?
I want to go in that cloakroom again. Not the cloakroom. You can't go in the cloakroom.
Can't go in the cloakroom.
Maybe I can just hand a beer through.
That would be fun.
I can watch a page hand a beer through.
Yeah, that'd be so cool.
They have this little passageway where they can hand notes to people in the cloakroom.
Oh, but
it's
no.
It's members only. It's, yeah.
Each party has their own.
Yeah.
There's only two rooms. Mm-hmm. You know why? America. So, yeah, they each have their own party room and no one gets to go in.
This is just a stream of consciousness. Podcast, right?
I know. I don't know what's wrong with me. Oh yeah. Where's the beer value though?
I just talked about handing a beer through to a representative. No. So yeah, we're going to DC to do some lobbying. You are leaving Sunday. I'm leaving earlier than that. Our big day is Tuesday, I think.
That's correct.
Wednesday. Wednesday.
Yeah.
So we have a whole day.
I'm on the overnight Sunday.
I know. I convinced you to do a red eye and then I bailed on it.
Okay.
I'm going earlier. Should I tell that story? Why not?
Sure. I mean, yeah. I mean, you'll have more of a story to tell on the next week.
All right. If we get to it.
If we ever get out of this podcast.
If you're watching the video, you will find somebody who knows their left from right. I can't get it on the big camera, but.
That is.
I'll have a story about this tattoo.
That is Rob's favorite tattoo.
It's my only tattoo.
True. Both things.
So I'm going to Montgomery, Alabama. I guess I'll talk about that.
Sure.
Oh, we're going to have to do a podcast in DC probably on Monday night. And we're going to have to keep it real simple. And I know you're going, Rob, that's your job to keep it simple because I keep adding these layers of complexity to it.
It's good 18 camera layout now.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's what's happened and what's going on, I think, right?
That's what happened. That's what's going on. Oh, we have the 29-year anniversary of Flagstaff Brewing Company is today.
It's today, but... by the time you listen to this, if you're up there in Flagstaff on the 21st, Jeff Thorsett, the guy, the founder, will be playing in a band called Toxic Positivity on his patio. And if you're a jam band fan, if you like the Dead or Fish, I think you're going to be super impressed. they're very good, and he's a pretty good guitar player. But they don't like to really, I mean, maybe they will next year when it's 30, but I play this coy game of finding out when his celebration is going to be, but I don't think they're listing it as their 29th anniversary.
I was on all their social media and their website today, and there's no mention of it.
Yeah. But for people to sort of understand what was going on, like, when was the first time that you heard the phrase nano brewery?
Yeah, that was probably like at 2000.
2000? Okay. I remember maybe a little later than that when they started to do, I remember a CBC session where they had three breweries. And the one I remember is the one I heard about first. It was called Schooner Exact, and it was in Seattle. And they brewed out of a storage facility, like, you know, like U-Haul space, basically, right? Some other, not yeah. really U-Haul, but like they had a garage, it had power.
Self-storage, yeah.
And they somehow licensed that.
That's shocking.
Right, but then they got kicked out because I don't think the property owner understood what they were up for there. So they became a bigger brewery. I'm not sure if they're still around. I mean, I think they are, but they definitely became a bigger brewery. But then, like, what is it? In Colorado, the homebrew store, and of course, Homebrew Mart, and where else? The origin story of New Belgium, right? Was a square dairy tank. I don't know how many gallons you think that is. Two barrels worth.
Yeah,
yeah. That's the origin for Fat Tire and New Belgium Brewery. If you take the tour, they still have it. It's no bigger than, you know, a dining table.
Yep.
I mean, like a pub table.
Yeah, it's pretty.
So that is the same equipment that is still in use today at Flagstaff Beer Co. So in essence, in 1994, that was one of the first nano breweries in the country.
Yeah.
Because it's definitely smaller than some of the other things that we talked about.
Right. Yeah, it was a brand new law that became available in 94. And
yeah.
Beaver Street. Flag Brew, Prescott Brew, Gentle Ben's.
Electric in Bisbee.
Right.
Bandersnatch, maybe a year later.
Okay.
One of the OG breweries in the country. And it's like people ask, well, who was first? I mean, like, there's like when you get your license, when you brew your first batch.
When
you open the door, you might have sold beer outside of the location.
Or if you open the doors and you don't have your beer on, does that still count as your...
Yeah.
Right?
Right. And then, like...
It's complicated.
After a couple of years, you're like, do I really want my anniversary to be on a Tuesday?
Uh-huh. Do I want it to be in spring?
Over the course of 30 years, you can understand how that changes quite a bit.
Yeah.
And we can't even look up the licensing anymore because they changed some of the licensing structure, so... They're moving to a bigger number, so even brewers that are newer, they change their license number, and so that none of that stuff is really retained. But you can also file a state license years before you actually get a federal license or are open.
Right. So, there are breweries. I mean, I go on the Department of Liquor License Control website every week and look at new pending applications, and I go through quarterly and look at the active licenses, and there's always three or four breweries that definitely are not open.
Yeah, and never have been open.
And sometimes never do, which sucks. But the dates of their license really has nothing to do with anything.
Well, yeah. And there's a couple places that are, it's usually a bar that gets a license, and like I never know that it's never clear to me if they even did anything
intended to brew.
And all of a sudden, you look at the state report, and they made 50 gallons of beer, and then that's it. Like, okay, like it's a really expensive way to have a party, I guess. You can make that much as a home brewer,
right?
I don't know. It's yeah.
I mean, you could, like, if you were in a restaurant, could you just use a pot and make 10-gallon batches on the stove?
Sure.
You'd still have to do 161 barrels a year, right?
5,000 gallons.
That's a lot of times.
500 batches of beer.
That's a lot of times on the stove.
500 batches of beer over 365. Yeah. Not going to make it.
I mean, it's... You're going to get... They're going to pull that license.
I was going to say, you're going to run out of room. You got to put that beer somewhere. It's not like when you're done boiling, you're just done. It's got to go in some sort of container. It's got to sit for a while. It's got to go in some...
It's true. I've heard of this about the brewing process.
Yeah, yeah. That's a rundown of a lot of stuff, but I'd like to take a break, and we're going to talk about some things I have on this piece of paper.
Great. All right, we'll see you in a minute. Do 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 do.
We have break music.
I just made it. You're welcome.
Peek into what happens during the break. I like how when you took a break, you're out of the camera and like you could be like over there smoking a cigarette. Yeah. I'm on the camera. I'm on break. I'm never on break. No. I'm always in the, yeah. I went hat shopping. When I go to...
we don't have any paid endorsements on this show. That, no money is exchange hands or goods or services.
Kitty corner from it. So, and I like this...
This is my
inexpensive version of the hats that I wear. It's like straw. I need to hit it with the waterproof spray because yeah. I'm going to sweat through this band in 10 minutes.
In D.C.?
Well, and today,
Alabama?
Yeah. Yeah, I gotta come up with a unified hat strategy because like there's a lot of different things. I got to wear baseball hats. I got to wear these kinds of hats, maybe a dressier one. They don't really pack in your bag very well.
No, they don't. I don't have anything like... I mean, I have the suit, which is challenging enough since I'm committed to carry-on only.
I got some more packable shoes. I like to wear my Keens that have the waterproof lining in them, and they're dressy enough that no one's going to kick you out of a restaurant.
But, I got some new shoes for this trip.
Yeah, I mean, we have to have the shoes that go with the suit.
Mm-hmm.
Although, you know, this could be in the content of the part. I follow this guy on Twitter. I can't remember his name. Derek. I don't know. He gets political photographs and critiques the suits.
Fashion.
A thing right now is to wear a suit with white-soled sneakers. But like, you know, cat and like there's a lot of
that's what I have.
Yeah.
That's their dress on the top.
Yeah.
White sole sneakers on the bottom.
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing. Like
there are some that are more prevalently white sole sneakers. Mine is a little more subtle. A little toned down from those big boys.
All right. Maybe that'll be part of our podcast.
Perhaps.
But anyway, you know, Biden wears them because Obama sure as hell did. And I don't know. He goes on all. He's his whole big thing is like if you are in this political world, like why do you have such ill fitting clothing?
Yeah, I I just don't know how to wear fancy clothes.
Did you get yours tailored?
No. I got a new suit.
Yeah, I know.
I got a new suit, and then I wore it to Adam and Jesse's wedding.
Yeah,
and then I took the jacket back and got a little bit bigger jacket.
They didn't take it in or anything like that. Where'd you go?
Kohl's.
But they don't do that there.
No, no.
All right. Well, I'm gonna look at it, and
it's
I will
good.
Make some,
you get it's tailored. Good. Like, it's way better than the one I had last year.
Getting it tailored doesn't cost that much.
Yeah.
Just brought in a little bit. Get the sleeves right.
I'm feeling pretty good about it,
okay,
honestly.
All right.
Yeah, pretty good. The tie is a situation I need to address.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a blue suit. I think I'm going to wear a pink shirt.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm going to go back with the seersucker and probably a white shirt.
I am a little disappointed that this suit is not the one I wanted, because the one I wanted, they're not carrying anymore. And so the sizes were all janky. Mm. So I did not get that. Sad news. Mm. This one I have now is a little warmer.
I think I have like three or four, maybe. And I try to mix them up every year, but it's going to be too hot. And I don't have anything that, I don't know. Well, we'll see. I'll make the call. You might see me in a blue suit. Who knows?
Well, here's the problem. You're getting on an airplane on Friday.
Yeah.
So you're going to have, are you going to check bags?
I am trying not to.
Ah, now the master has become the student. The student has become the master. Yeah.
You know what I'm going to do less of is wear, because like we're in DC, I don't feel like on Monday I have to wear a guild shirt or whatever. So on the days that we're off, because we're there more days, but I think we have more off days.
Monday we're off. Mm-hmm. Tuesday is work all day. Wednesday is work all day. Thursday we leave at 7:30 in the morning.
I'm just saying I'm not going to wear a variety. I might wear a lot of the same stuff as most people do when they travel.
Yeah.
Like because we're trying to be in the public eye and all that stuff, but I think I'm going to dial that down.
The new little lapel pins we have. Game changer. You can wear any shirt you want is now a work shirt.
That's true. You know, where was I? We were at Phoenix Beer Co. And they just have subtly on the pocket, PHX beer. I like that too. So.
Who has that?
Phoenix Beer Co.
Yeah. Which person had that?
Adam.
Yeah?
Adam's a very stylish guy. Yeah.
He always wears nice clothes.
Yeah. So, but I mean, I've noticed that I think Sierra Nevada started to do that for a while. You know, you go to their company store and they just, it's very subtle.
Just little.
Yeah, just the words.
It's like the old days.
Yeah.
When you had to embroider it by hand.
We just got off the phone.
Hey, Rob.
Yeah.
Welcome back.
You know, we never did the hey. Andrew Bauman.
Hey, Rob. Andrew Bauman. Damn it.
Wow. It's a real sign of
this. This is a real mess, this podcast today.
Yeah. It's all right, though. I mentioned earlier in the show, I talked to John Hall, and we talked about festivals, and we talked about right, there was a Slate article that says, hey.
Oh, remember how we took a break and I didn't get myself a beverage?
Oh, yeah. So we're taking another break. Andrew, we're back. You have a beverage.
Rob.
I thought you had a beverage and now you have another beverage.
Yeah, I have another one waiting in case I need it. I mean, we're 34 minutes in.
If we use all that stuff.
That's true.
I mentioned at the start of the show that I had talked to John Hall, and I think there's a couple things I'd like to visit with you on since you were not on that, but you have opinions on it, and we can talk maybe longer about it. There was a piece in Slate talking about the beer industry is flat, now what? I think also, have you met Don Say from All About Beer podcast?
No.
He wrote for Forbes, similar article, that the beer market's flat. The thing is, we've talked about that since January.
Well, longer than that, I think.
Yeah, but I remember.
I think for 2 years. I think CBC last year was when he said, hey, everyone, heads up.
Right.
You're not going to see any growth.
Yeah, I think they were. So I've had the luxury of seeing Art talk a few more times, and like, yeah, it's he was definitely preparing, but I think he predicted modest growth, but it's come down.
Okay.
But in any case, like, this is nothing that we don't know, and anecdotally, I think a lot of people are feeling it. But as we explained, you can be flat and still do okay in this industry. Like, the industry could flat. In fact, you could be flat as a business, but if you're paying your bills and making some money. It's you know, like, it's not sustainable to have, it's not realistic to have constant growth.
Right. And the here's the meteoric growth of the beer industry was never sustainable. It was exciting. It was fun. It was amazing.
Sure.
It's not sustainable, but you never know when that trap door is going to open.
Sure.
But now we do know. Now we know when.
Right. If you have periods of growth like that, you get a lot of people into the industry based on speculation. And I mean, I think we've seen some of that, but like it's, you know, it's the classic gold rush, right? If the more gold that's pulled out, the more people who are interested until it reaches a rational level and, you know, people get out. And so it has to come down. If it doesn't come down, then what you have is a lot of people getting in the industry who arguably shouldn't be in. And when I say arguably, there's people out there like, there's already too many people in the industry.
Right, right. And the thing is, it's I know it sounds like I say this every single podcast. The Arizona beer industry is not the same as the national beer industry. Mm-mm. And there are states that are way far ahead in that cycle compared to us. And if you're looking at national stats, what does that really mean to your brewery? What does that really mean to your city? What does that mean to your state? Not that much, really. Sure. I mean,
well,
it is something that you should be aware of, that you should keep your eye on and think about when you're making business decisions. But it doesn't mean that the world's crumbling down just because 10 breweries in Colorado closed last year, right?
Sure, sure. And, you know, we've talked about larger cities that towns, or especially when they're remoter than most. We talked about a place like Casa Grande. Like, if you open a brewery in Casa Grande, you are not going to have flat business. You're going to have
exponential growth
for a while.
Yeah.
So there are still, so it's possible to be flat and still have areas of opportunity that are could be through the moon.
There's so much opportunity in this state right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you compare our numbers to other states' numbers, we are so underperforming in number of breweries, volume per person, all of these things. Yep. And that's
per capita consumption is super low.
Like, it's insane.
Like 40th.
But all that means is that we've got so much room to grow and that we're not in that nasty place. That's all. And,
exactly.
And I have breweries reaching out to me at least once a month. It feels like more than that in the last couple months of new breweries that are in planning, and most of them are not going to open and that's okay. But some of them will.
Right. Right. I think subscribers of a certain local restaurant and bar, Mouth by Southwest, read a story about the purchase of a brewery. I actually can't stand by that story yet because I haven't heard directly, but like it makes sense. Like, you know, the new entry to the market maybe already has some built-in contracts or capacity already spoken for. Those are kind of the things that you can expect. Does that mean that one went out of business? I guess. I mean, sometimes going out of business doesn't mean you lost any money.
There's a lot of reasons that businesses close.
Sure, sure. So the point is, and this was brought home by Mr. Hall, is that something that customers recognize or see, or is that something that businesses feel? It depends. Like, he talked about, like, if I go into a new brewery, I want to enjoy the space. I want to experience the camaraderie. I want to see how excited they are to feature products. I'm like, that's great. So yeah, you might not see this. And I didn't get into it on the podcast, but we talked about the hidden market. There are people who buy products that I don't drink. I don't know whose favorite beer that is, but a ton of people drink them. Right. So, all these things are true.
Oh, I went to my aunt's the other day.
Yep.
And I had to do some little handyman stuff around the house. Mm-hmm. On the way home, I picked up a 6-pack of Moda Sonora. IPA. Delicious. And I referred to it as plumber juice while I was repairing the toilet. I need more plumber juice. Bring me some more plumber juice. That's awesome. Great. It was great.
Oh, you wrote that down. You can talk about it. Are you just taking notes so you don't forget?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
You're still working on your...
Oh, yeah. No. Yeah. So we talked about that. And I wanted to try. I could talk about festivals. Let's talk about what you want to talk about. Because one of them is festivals, but go ahead.
Okay. Well, let's talk about festivals.
Oh, okay.
I'm very passionate about that.
There's also a Slate article that says festivals are dead.
I think it was Vine Pair. I don't know.
No. It was Axios. Axios Denver, but it got picked up nationally. Yeah. And I come to find out on that call, they talked to Shawnee in Colorado, the executive director there, and they did not put in a lot of her information about their festivals. In general, Colorado festivals, they cite a couple of them, and the downturn in attendance at GABF. But they didn't take her events. She talked about her events and how they're doing fine. So again, flat or down doesn't mean everyone's flat or down. But on the podcast, I said, we do festivals for all kinds of reasons. And yes, revenue is an important part of some of them. But, we came into this not wanting to necessarily talk about Real Wild and Woodsy, but that festival changed our relationship with a lot of breweries because we solved problems together with them and we spent time with them and more of their peers got to go to their locations. And it was a different mix than other festival participants potentially in that area. So yeah, I mean, we do things for all kinds of reasons. And you could quote me as saying in that, if I was in that article that attendance has been going down in some of our events, but we've made more revenue and some of them sort of, it's okay. Like we can shed that amount of people because we want the experience level to be high. And
standing around drinking beer in a parking lot is not going to cut it for a festival.
No, and it's not what we do. And I said there's some brand confusion because even people who work in this industry assume that we have a piece of some of the festivals that we don't
have. They think we run every single festival in this state.
No, I know. So same thing. I think we struggle sometimes identifying that this is our festival, this is why it's important. But not every festival has to, we should be designing festivals to accomplish different things. And revenue is one, total number of attendees. Like if the goal was to get more beer in front of more people, we'd lower the price. But scale is a problem. Like you just keep marginally adding dozens and dozens of people. At some point, something you have to have more fence, more bathrooms. The locations sometimes won't
parking
allow you to have those.
Yeah.
So like they're all decisions you make. Our festivals
like we
are
made
fine.
Decisions at Real Wild and Woodsy. We could have had more people in. Mm-hmm. We said, no, that's going to be it.
Probably could have added 200 people without a problem.
I mean,
without changing it.
Logistically, we could not have added 200 more people
because we didn't
this
have
year.
We couldn't have the cups. But I'm saying
we could have found plastic cups, right?
On that footprint. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We can add. We could definitely add more. But I think that
if we had
we could have added another 50 that day, but we chose not to because we said this is what we wanted to be. This enough. We're done.
Yeah. Yeah. So. So there was a lot of that discussion.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Good. Great. Oh, yeah. Which one?
Let's talk about where we had lunch yesterday.
Oh, yeah. We had lunch at my favorite brewery from Mexico by far.
Yeah.
Number one favorite Andrew endorsed brewery, Buki Bishi.
Right. They have a tap room in Chandler.
Right. 3 miles from my house. Buki Bishi is now selling 15 of their beers. 13.
That's right. And they have a menu with two sides.
Fantastic menu.
I would say 25 items on there, maybe. Yeah.
Tacos, hamburgers, pizza,
pork, beef.
Other specialty items.
Yeah.
So those tacos are great. Mm-hmm. Lots of fish on the menu, which is unusual.
So Ukibishi is a allied member of the guild.
And have been for years.
Yeah. And they're not full members because they don't brew in the state. And also, because we're a lobbying organization, we can't pretend to assist on any issues that are in Mexico, clearly.
Uh-huh. So, well, yeah. we can assist our breweries into helping get their beer down there.
Right. But they're an important member because of a couple of reasons. One is, they sat down and said, hey, the next biggest city to Hermosillo, where they are based, and they are one of the largest brew pub chains in Mexico.
They have seven locations?
Is the next biggest market is Tucson. So we want to spend time in Tucson. So we invite them to our festivals. They have, in fact, you mentioned Dragoon. They have collaborated with them, among others. This is just the most recent. They're partners with Quail.
They are distributed by Quail, and they participate in Strong Beer every year. They participate in Baja Beer Fest every year. Right. Yeah, they're great supporters of Arizona beer too.
Yeah. So we are a sister city with Hermosillo. I want to work
That's so amazing.
I want to work on partnerships. I want to make it easier for us to bring product down there for their events and potentially to sell beer. And we talked about this with Ayla. You know, I want that to be something that if our breweries and I think they will because they're already taking part in it without our help. If we can make that easier, all the better. And, I'm super impressed with the beer quality that they bring up here. Ayla stressed the fact that their breweries are run super professionally.
Clean.
Yeah.
So, get off the floor clean.
Yeah. So I think education, both brewery technical. I think there's a lot of potential for exchange of information. And, that is a struggling legislative. If the laws there favor bigger breweries more so than our laws. So I think there's some lessons there in understanding, even though we can't represent them, we can understand what we can learn from their experience as well and vice versa. So,
right.
For all those reasons, I'm hoping that they, we're hoping to meet with them again now that they're in the state, maybe to double down on our relationship a little bit and, put them in contact with our breweries, even though they already do that to some extent. Being in Phoenix, I think Phoenix is like, what? What's going on here? Yeah, a few of them here, right?
Really?
Yeah.
They're surprised that Ukibishi is here?
I bet.
Oh, I don't know.
Not all of them. I mean,
well, I've been tight with them for the whole time that I was brewing. So like as soon as they were around, I was just amazed. Like, awesome. We have international reach coming up with craft beer from Mexico. That is so exciting. So I always loved hanging out with those guys. And
right.
Ranch Hand did a collab with them, 1912, Button, all these people that are like my homies have all already done.
But generally speaking, Southern Arizona.
Southern Arizona mostly, yeah.
You can understand where, I don't know what their production is. I don't know what their canning capability is. But, I'd like to get them in touch with Santan and Huss and Phoenix Beer Co. and, Grand Canyon for that matter.
Like a lot of times they're working with those Quail breweries.
It's true.
Ah, makes sense.
Yeah, yeah.
Talk to us. What's up?
I'm just featuring the beer I'm drinking from Rent House, which is a Czech pale lager. This is actually the more aggressive of the... What? Is it off? It's all right, man. Don't worry.
All right. Sorry.
It's all right. We might just go to a two-shot. Anyway.
They have engraved plates.
What?
They're plates.
Who?
At Ukibishi. Oh, sorry.
Oh, I was just saying it would be super cool if we also had like a Czech brewery have tap room here.
A Czech brewery and a brewery from Hermosillo and an Arizona brewery all collabing together.
The sister cities. It would be cool to have that. But I did read an article in Browelt magazine.
Oh boy, how do you get that?
I don't know. I just started getting it. It's a German magazine.
It's like $300 a year subscription. So congratulations.
I should bring in my
I should bring it in. I love
but
that.
there was an article about how in Prague their brew pub scene hasn't bounced back. And in reading the article, I'm like, there is a similarity there. So like, not only would we like to interface with those breweries on brewery technical issues, and certainly would be like, it would be my life's work if I could somehow facilitate Czech style open fermentation and relationship built through that. That would be awesome. But if that doesn't happen, like, we could talk about bringing people back to the tap room and the cultural differences and all that stuff. So
yeah,
it's all coming together.
and in Mexico, the way to get Prague and Mexico together is going to be something. It's amazing what's going on in that brain, Rob.
I haven't even added Vancouver. Not Vancouver, Calgary.
Right, Calgary too. Oh boy.
Mm-hmm. 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 So.
So I am having a good by the Shop Beer Co. It's a collab with Boulevard and Pivot Cycles from Tempe. Hmm. Yeah, it's tasty. Oh God, it's 8.1%. Oh well.
It's the afternoon.
I guess I'll have a nap later. The other thing that we can talk about, wait, the article about franchise, and one thing that was very, do you remember that?
No.
This morning? Okay.
The letter, the TTB stuff. Is that what you're talking about?
We can talk about that now, yeah?
No, let's talk about
okay,
that.
Okay,
let's talk about that in DC.
Okay, great. Mm-hmm. So, there's always the debate about franchise law. Is it good for us? Is it bad for us? But what a different perspective that had not ever been elucidated to me was that franchise law very much protects small breweries, because large breweries who are doing 80% of a distributor's business could say, you can't bring any more small breweries in or we're pulling out.
Yeah, there are some inherent protections. This is the Doug Velike article. I haven't read it yet.
Okay.
I knew it was coming out. I haven't read it yet. So we can talk about that when I've read it.
Great.
But yeah.
We'll move on to that.
Yeah.
Now you do it. You say it.
Anchor. so let's talk about why Anchor closed. Because if you're reading something in the general media right now, it's the sob story about the pandemic and how they couldn't recover from the pandemic.
Well, there is a lot of
it's not true.
Yeah, there's a lot of not true, but there's also a lot of nostalgia that you can't overcome nostalgia with facts. That's one of the problems.
Yeah, yeah. So if you have been listening to us and you, I don't know if it's free or if you have to subscribe, but Dave Infante broke the story about Anchor One. Reducing their footprint to statewide, getting rid of the Christmas beer, and I can't believe there wasn't a Fox headline: Bay Area brewery cancels Christmas.
It writes itself.
I know. So then it turned into, oh, you know, they're looking for a buyer, and then it turned into, no, we're shutting down operations, and Mr. Infante. Fingers newsletter and Twitter, as you get most of the story, sort of indicated like...
And Blue Sky.
Yeah. This has been known by the company for a while that this was part of the plan because of who they hired to communicate these messages and because the stories broke at the same time and they were embargoed and held. And so you just got one side of the narrative. And in the meantime... Dave Infante has been talking to the workers there, and they had a union contract that hadn't been negotiated since January. And they talked about they are already pulling back production. I think they made 800 barrels last quarter. So if you have an operation like that, you don't accidentally do that. Like, right. Cause you've got supply chain, you've got, you have contracts
on your supplies. You have contracts on your distribution, right. All of that.
So there's a plan to close this brewery and you have a succinct way of putting it that I didn't.
Oh, okay. They hired a crisis PR firm.
Yeah.
And before they even announced being closed, this crisis management PR firm was answering questions from the media. And that is not a good sign.
And also, he represents one of the newspapers.
Yes. So
as a client.
Mm. So my...
Why do you feel
my
like
wife and I were discussing this, mm-hmm. and I said, Sapporo bought Anchor because they wanted to be able to produce Sapporo in the United States and not have to put it on a boat, and that's for sure.
Yep.
They said that
2017
mm-hmm. in 2010, Anchor was sold to Finlandia Vodka's holding company. Mm-hmm. So they've since 2010. They have been held by a non-beer entity, essentially.
Right.
Then 2017, Sapporo buys it, says, hey, we are going to buy this brewery. We're going to make Sapporo beer there, plus continue that brand.
Right.
Cute, cute.
Plus the affinity between San Francisco and the Pan-Asian
belt of market.
Like,
absolutely.
Like, should have been tapped into, could have been tapped into.
Mm-hmm. And then...
They rebranded.
First, they bought Stone Brewing Company
mm-hmm.
because the brewery equipment at Anchor wasn't well suited for making rice lagers.
Right. They have open fermentation. They top crop their yeast.
So the system just wasn't great for the kind of beer that they intended to make.
It's wonderful for the kind of beer they already make. Right.
So once they acquired Stone, that was kind of like the writing was on the wall. Like, that's it. We bought Anchor. Oops, made a mistake. Let's buy Stone. We bought that. Now we can make our rice lager in the US, mm-hmm. maintain a few of the Stone brands. We've already seen Stone brands getting slashed in favor of production of the other, of the Sapporo lager. You know, that's all fine. It's their business to run however they want. Mm-hmm. And so when Anchor closed, it wasn't that big of a shock, I guess, to me, because it was pretty obvious that they didn't want to continue brewing beer there. They have Stone now. Why do I want to deal with this? Now, why they would just decide to close it and throw it away, I don't know. They could have sold it for pennies on the dollar, but at least that would be pennies.
The reason they're not selling it is because the property is worth more than the brewery.
Ah, got it.
That piece of real
estate
makes
tons of sense. Sure,
is worth more than the entire brewery, and I don't.
They bought it for $87 million or 67? 87. 67. So that building and that property is worth more than $87 million.
Yes, that's what I'm told. I mean, talking about San Francisco.
Hey, hey.
You know, and you can build a high rise on it, right?
I don't know. I'm not a civil engineer.
So all those things. And so this is what sort of, this is why this is different because it's such a cynical way. You could talk about when ABI brought brands or Miller Coors or Heineken for that matter, you know, and you can say, oh, well, you know, that's just a bunch of talk and they're going to strip the brands and all this other stuff. Like, I just don't think it was as cynical as I've seen this go down.
Yeah.
Especially with the advanced PR, and we were supposed to already have a funeral for Anchor because of the pandemic. That's literally what they're saying. And like, so they're like, this is how we make the medicine go down. And like, you know, like most people read that story. I'm like, oh, that's really a shame. And it fits into, you know, these left and right politics. Oh yeah, if you're on the right, oh yeah, the pandemic, our government killed businesses. You're on the left, like, oh yeah, I can understand, like, it's been tough. It was masterful on that level, but it is so cynical. No, because
it wasn't masterful because I see right through it. Like, but I'm not that smart.
But you're not most people.
Okay.
I mean, you talked about it. Like most people, and here's the other thing. Talking about people, I saw people post like, oh, I guess I didn't drink enough of Anchor, or I forgot,
or I didn't sell enough, or I didn't,
or yeah, like
should have done more Anchor promos.
I could have put them on tap more. I'm like, that is just your ego speaking, 100%. Like when they did the rebrand, it was an acknowledgement, just like another famous case of someone understanding the demographic.
And that was like a year ago they did the rebrand?
Yeah, but they didn't back it with anything.
No.
There was nothing behind it. But the acknowledgement was we need to grow our younger crowd and this is what they're going to identify. And they spent no time or money or energy on it. And I don't know if that was just a Hail Mary or again, if this is part of the plan. But like Anchor shouldn't rely on most people we know to support them. That should be a growing brand. Getting people who, because it's such a, it can be such a craft adjacent brand, right? It fits in for a lot of people like Leinenkugel or Narragansett or some of the FX
Rolling Rock.
I don't want to take away from any of those brands. Yeah, Yingling. I don't want to take away from any of those brands, but like it's not like super boastfully hazy IPA or whatever people who don't have a favorable for craft, like, well, this is a,
they're easily approachable beers.
Right. And so they didn't spend any time or money on it. And like, so like nobody who used to drink Anchor had drank Anchor once or twice or.
I have a little story.
Great. Tell it.
This is what we do on here, right?
Yeah.
So when I was in college, I worked at Chili's and when all the staff would get done right across the street, like a little tiny street, mm-hmm. was the Lone Star Oyster Bar. And the Lone Star Oyster Bar only had one type of glassware, and that was a giant fishbowl mug, whatever, right. Fishbowl. Frozen.
Yeah.
Always.
Oh, like the goblet.
Big, giant chalice. Goblet. Mm-hmm. Huge. Weighs like 5 pounds, just the goblet without it's anything like
Arcadia
in it.
Arcadia Tavern does that.
I believe you. And it's always frozen.
Mm-hmm.
And the Bud Light goes great in there, the Coors Light, the Shiner Bock goes great in there, the Lone's, everything. And I wanted craft because I was an idiot back then. This is 90, I got married in 94. So this is 92, 93.
Right.
94. They would always keep 2 Anchor Steam on the back bar for me.
Mm.
So that when I poured it into that frozen mug, it would
equalize out.
Ish. Yeah. Be warmer.
They'd be at room temperature.
It wouldn't have ice in it.
Right.
So that was my beer that I drank after every shift.
Yeah.
Right there. Mm-hmm. So a lot of Anchor in my life, but I'm not crying about it being gone because like in 2010, they sold to Finlandia. So like after that, I kind of didn't care.
Yeah. I mean, I get that. It just made me angry the way this was done.
Now you fuck with Sierra Nevada and we're going to have some problems.
Yeah.
Big problems.
I would get the Christmas beer maybe 2 out of mm-hmm. 4 years. You know,
we would get the Christmas beer every year, even when we moved to Boise.
And it was a standing handle at the Main Ingredient.
Nice.
So I would get it when I was there. Yeah. Steam. And I remember as a homebrewer, it was a beer that I had to relearn about. So I came to appreciate it differently because I had it. And then like, I don't care about it. And then I going through the style, I was like, all right, let's try this again. And like, you know, because of that, I look fondly on it. But
yes.
Like I'm not responsible for buying every brand's beer. Neither are you, neither is anyone else. But for anyone to say, you know, like, oh, they abandoned their craft fans or any of that bullshit is completely fucked. A brand like that, when you go national,
you have to do.
You have to get consumers that don't say they're craft beer consumers.
That is what I could get in Lubbock, Texas in 1993.
Yeah. So
I mean, that's kind of a big deal. I couldn't get Sierra Nevada back there.
So even if you didn't ever buy one of their beers or you bought it once and you're not responsible for it. But I mean, you can regret that it's not there. I was ready to let the story go, but when we talked and what we've read and the way it was managed, I just hope this doesn't signal a completely cynical, cause like we've never been like, Wall Streeted out of shit. You know, remember the movie Gordon Gekko, like just liquidating companies just to liquidate them. Like that hasn't really been part of the buyout experience. And if that's going to be the way it is, then yeah, this is not a good time.
Right.
For any of us.
Absolutely. I don't want to bring up the monster in the room, but I just did. What?
The monster in the room?
What'd you say? Sorry, I missed it.
So, I don't know. That's something that that's a take you might not hear from anyone else right now. So there you go.
There you go.
What else we got? We didn't even talk about any of this stuff.
Kernza beer.
Well, we could talk about it a little bit.
I need to learn more about it.
Yeah. We'll just briefly say that there are a couple of grains that you might see out in the wild. No pun. Mm-hmm. Arizona Wilderness is part of a multi-brewery collaboration with Patagonia, Sierra Nevada, Russian River, Allagash, Odell, a couple of others. I didn't list them all. But
so Patagonia, the...
The
outdoor equipment company.
Right, right. They're a B corporation, if you know what that means. They're a socially conscious, environmentally conscious company. Their goods cost more generally because they look at their entire supply chain. They try to have the lowest impact. A lot of your stuff that's synthetic is, you know, recycled bottles, and they try to source their things in a mindful way. I think you can get their origin story online for free as an audiobook. It's called Let My People Surf. Interesting story about the genesis of that company. He started out as a climbing equipment company, and he made his own goods.
Carabiners. And
Yeah. But
harnesses.
This is the ethos, and they developed a beer with a grain called Kernza, and it's supposed to be low impact, low water use.
It's not malted. It's not going to bring a lot of fermentable sugar to the game,
right?
But it is going to impact flavor and texture and protein and things like that. So, a useful grain to you're not going to use it as your base malt, but mm-hmm. bring it in and. I'm sure that you could roast it. I'm sure that you could perhaps use enzymes to convert some of those starches.
Right.
So it has a place in the brewing industry. Right.
I've had it. You're not going to mistake it for most beers. It has a distinct flavor because of those things. It is an alcoholic beverage. It is a grain. It is refreshing. I think it's still on tap at Arizona Wilderness.
I think so.
So maybe... If you try that, maybe that's something that you maybe won't cool. explain to you when yeah. you get poured in.
I mean, Wilderness does a lot of those things using their Sinagua malts.
Yeah.
And they do all kinds of indigenous plants in their beers. And they come out with like two new beers a week. It's so crazy. Yeah. Some of them are rehashed, but yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So, in fact, when we were at Old Ellsworth, two of their beers are Sinagua. So those are crops that are supposed to be designed to be low impact. Like our grains here, malted here, cost more for the brewery, but lower impact on the environment, save water here in Arizona. It's just something that we like to talk about. But my wife does not prefer that grain flavor. It's very distinctive.
The Sinagua?
Yeah. Mm. So far it's... She's got a very distinct taste that she does not prefer. A mm-hmm. couple of them, and that's one of them. But like I like it. But I'm also able to say, well, this isn't beer. Like I know beer. This is just something different when it comes to that kind of thing.
Right.
Just reading about another grain called Fonio. It's Senegalese. Mr. Garrett Oliver has partnered with a couple of Senegalese West African brewers. I haven't had it, but it just came up in my feed. But it says it's a...
Low water impact, right?
Yeah. Super low water impact. In fact, I looked into it because it can thrive in 23 inches of a year of water. In Arizona, in Phoenix in particular, we get 32. So, I mean, we don't get them on the regs. So, like,
wow.
But, like, the point is that it doesn't have to be irrigated where they're growing it in Africa. But it has a slight bitterness to it, the grain. And he says, Garrett Oliver says, amino acid bitterness, kind of like the backbone of sake. So, again, a different kind of cool beverage. And I don't know. I'm excited to look in to see if we can sample that somewhere. Fonio, F-O-N-I-O.
And or if we can make it. Yeah. We do know how to make beer.
But it's all the same things you talked about. Like it doesn't have, in reading some of the comments online, it doesn't have diastatic power, meaning it would require enzymes to help convert sugars, potentially.
Or just put it with a high diastatic grain.
Right. As a blend.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of your modern malts have like double diastatic power where they could ferment two times as much starch as is actually in the barley corn. So
there you go. There's
you can call on those guys. One thing about using enzymes is that it's going to completely rip through everything. Mm. And so that cannot necessarily be what you're looking for. So if you're able to pair it with a grain that has high diastatic power, then you can get kind of the best of both worlds.
Potentially. I think
I'm willing to give it a shot.
I think, you know, with these, just like the dairy-based alcohol, until we see hundreds of versions of this, I mean, not personally drink them, but know of hundreds that are out there, we're not going to understand what the best version of it
sure,
is.
You know? Sure. I mean, you get two or three.
It won't be living its best life. That's right. What I'm saying.
Not living its best grain life. Yeah.
Yeah. So if anyone runs into those from Patagonia or Brooklyn for either one of these products, that's what you're signing up for.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Dig it.
Yeah.
Actual news about beer on the beer podcast. It's not about beer, but it's about beer.
It's not a beer podcast. It's a podcast about beer. It's not a I don't know how we do this anymore. I
think you did it right.
You don't listen to the episodes. You know, like
no.
When you couldn't get it right, I actually cut your voice up in the right order to say it.
I love it. I mean, I'm sorry.
I think that should wrap it up. I mean, I got some stuff about Gen X flavors, but... You know, what they prefer. We talked about that too.
Yeah.
You want to get into it?
No. All right. Save that for 2 weeks.
A rainy day.
Yeah. This week is this. Next week is live from DC. And then the following week, we can talk about whatever. Or maybe we find a guest to talk because that'd be great.
Yeah. We should do better at that.
Yeah.
We should do better about that. And we should.
Maybe we can get Greg Stanton.
Maybe.
Might have some time. I don't know.
Like
he's fun, dude.
Generally, the representatives aren't supposed to necessarily be there, but it sounded like from the invite that he was going to be there. So I don't know.
Oh, boy.
All right.
We could do a podcast from the Library of Congress with Greg Stanton.
I don't think we're destined to be in the Library of Congress on this trip.
I guess
you to disappoint you, but I think
you have to ask Greg. And also they have public hours.
Yeah, I guess so.
Okay.
We lost all that right. Camera. It's a all sign.
Right. All right. Time to roll, guys. Hey, Rob. Great catching up. Have a good time in Montgomery.
Yeah.
Alabama.
I'm going to have a great time.
I know you will.
I'll let you know all about it. When we talk next.
Sometimes the beer finds you.
Thank you. It did find us today. And remember, this is not a beer podcast. It's a podcast. podcast about beer. I did that backwards. Doesn't matter. It's not a podcast about beer. It's a beer podcast.
No, you had it right the first time.
It works both ways. It's
yes.
It's like a palindrome. But not.
Oh, shit. Oh, what just happened?
Oh, my God.
Thought that was a head on the table moment for sure.
No, my chair was locked and then it became unlocked.